Bonsoir, tout le monde. And thanks, Denis and Christian, for this invitation and for bringing this together, such a nice event with a very nice lineup of speakers. And I realized a few minutes ago that the other three speakers are all chairs of geography or either water, while my only academic chair is the one in my office. So it makes me a bit nervous, so please try to be nice. I will discuss this evening with you, and hopefully, I forgot to put my timer on. Hopefully within the time allocated. I'm used to speak for 150, usually 100 minutes. So 10 minutes is gonna be difficult, but let's try. So I will discuss with reference with a few case studies around the globe, how dams can and should be examined as material and technical objects. And indeed, as I'm sure Chris Sneddon is going to very eloquently explain, also as technopolitical objects. And these objects are entangled with humans and with their social and political systems. So as such, the interrelation between dams and humans, or if you want, between dams and civilizations, has evolved across space and time, and the two have arguably co-constituted one another. So dams can become a central tool in the deployment of a social and spatial engineering strategy aimed at ordering water flows, space, and population worldwide. So this raises a few interesting questions for scholars, and scholars have been indeed addressing these questions during the last few years. So for instance, has the way in which we see dams today changed compared to, say, 100 years ago? And if so, why? What has changed? And in relation to this, how is one of the dominant ways in which we can conceptualize political space and territory today, the nation state, linked with dams? I will address these questions in my talk, and to do so I will draw from my research, current, past research and future research, to give you a general overview of these matters. And I will be doing so by following the threads of space and time. So I thought I would start with this headline from The Guardian that was published, I think, about a month ago, yes. And so apparently, and for those of you who have been in England last year over the summer, it's not hard to believe this, England could run short of water within 25 years. This is due mostly to climate change and also increasing population. And Sir James Bevan, who is the chief executive of the British Environmental Agency, said that this could be avoided with a few measures. So ambitious action to cut people's water use, more desalination plants, transfers of water across the country, but most of all, big reservoirs, more big reservoirs. So it seems that the solution to our water problems in England, two or three decades from now, lies prominently on big dams. So nothing new. And let's now move to another setting that I know quite well. I have a perfect British accent, but I'm not British, to your surprise. I come from this place, this island in Italy, Sardinia. As you might see from this map, it's really a topological map in the sense that dams are dots in this map. And it's very telling. So, and I will tell you why. So we started building dams in the 1860s, and we built, over the last 150 years, around 60 dams. Every river in Sardinia has been dammed. We have around 10% of the total dams that there are in Italy. What is missing is a network linking these dams with one another. So water in Sardinia is scarce today, and it's not scarce in absolute terms, but it's unequally distributed between different users and sectors. The interests and uses of tourism, cities and towns, industry, agriculture, shepherds, so on. So we can argue that water scarcity, as we see it in this map, we don't see actually water scarcity, but water scarcity in Sardinia is artificially manufactured. It is manufactured also by dams, and it's a paradox, and the decisions that we make on how to allocate the water that we store in the dams. So dams provide technology and capacity to store water. It is up to us to decide how we allocate this water. And now let's move to this image. Does anyone know what this thing is? Have you got any idea? I know someone here knows. Yeah?
Yeah, okay,
it's a turbine. It's a Francis turbine from the Grand Coulee Dam in the US. I think he still maybe today the largest dam in terms of hydroelectricity capacity. I'm including this due to a memory that I have from the time that I spent living and working in Manchester. And I used to live in front of the Museum of Science and Industry, and I used to walk there often. And Manchester, as you might know, was a city that prospered during the Industrial Revolution, and the museum was displaying a few of these turbines. So the Francis turbine was invented by an engineer, James Francis, in 1848. So today, 170 years later, the Francis turbine is still the most common water turbine in use. This tells us at least three things. The first one is that the Francis turbine is a very good turbine. The second one is that technological advancement in the water turbines business has been a bit slow. The third one is that, and possibly the most important, is that dams can not only store water, but they also produce hydroelectricity. And indeed, as we have already discussed, there are a few reasons why we build dams, and we build dams to control water flows and control water in general. But we also build dams to produce energy, hydroelectricity. And this is very relevant in light of the increasing energy demand globally, in spite of the fact that we should be reducing our consumption. And also, it is very relevant because with dams we can have more irrigated agriculture. And this is, of course, important for an increasing food demand around the world. So while we've been building hydroelectric dams pretty much continuously during the last 150 years or so, the reasons why we build them have changed over time. For example, if we move to this map of the Aral Sea Basin in Central Asia, during the Soviet Union, particularly in the 1950s and 1960s, large dams were built both for large scale, we might say even irresponsible, irrigation projects that led eventually to the desiccation of the Aral Sea. 50 years or so later, in the post-Soviet republics, and particularly in the upstream ones, in Tajikistan and in Kyrgyzstan, we see that now these republics want to build dams mostly to produce hydroelectricity. This is the case of several dams in the region, in Tajikistan and Kyrgyzstan, and the governments that are building these dams tend to present them both to funders and to the international community as a clean source of renewable energy that will help us address the challenges posed by climate change. And this is often done using a rhetorical discourse that can sometimes be developed around the notion of sustainability. It is worth noting that several studies have shown that hydroelectricity is unfortunately not as clean as we thought it was. But the political imagination around dams in Central Asia is productive of a specific materiality of the nation state. Is a materiality that replaces the one left by the Soviet Union, which was very rich in its material capabilities and used Central Asia primarily as a source of raw materials. And also, as I have explored in some of my previous works, dams in Central Asia in this particular moment in time become particularly interesting to be observed as nation-building tools. It seems relevant and deserves to be studied, this phenomenon, in light of the current resurgence of nationalism around the world. And this can be linked to the current resurgence of the hydropower sector as well. And this leads me to my next point. This is linked to the set of justifications that over time we can use to promote the construction of large dams. I have explored this question in a paper that I've recently written with a few colleagues, and it was recently published in a journal called Environment and Planning C. In this paper, we looked at Mozambique to examine the relationship between hydraulic infrastructure and the production of state space. So we examined how discursive justifications of water infrastructure development by government agents can serve to solidify abstract imaginaries of the state. And this can evolve across various eras and regimes. And over time, hydraulic infrastructures, whether celebrated, contested, reimagined, replanned, planned, implemented, were mobilized to promote a symbolic and material expression of a given and very clear state imaginary. So in the case of Mozambique, over the last 90 years, we identified the making of three hydraulic paradigms, and they foster different imaginaries of the state and of the way in which we can engineer space, dams. So there was the Estado Novo during the time in which Mozambique was a Portuguese colony, and then the socialist post-independent state space where dams became sort of an agenda of a socialist regime, and then the neoliberal state. So it showed in the way in which there are internal and external drivers that can influence the dam construction business and in general the construction of hydraulic infrastructure. And these are the result of evolving historical, social and economic paradigms. So to conclude, the biggest mistake that we can make when we study dams is to study only dams. What I mean is that if we are to fully understand the processes that can lead to the planning, construction, contestation of a large dam, we need to historicize and contextualize this process. Today, dams are key in state and nation building processes around the world. We're not sure the nation states, a relatively recent political technology of power, will be around in a few decades, but we can be sure that dams will still be. It is up to us to decide how we look at them. Thank you.